Now we'll solve a example problem about this design of counter for retaining wall. Now look at this example. It is given. Design a counter for retaining wall for this following given particulars. First one is given, height of wall above ground level. Which is equal to 5.5 meter. Then safe bearing capacity of soil is given 160 kilonewton per meter square. Phi value is given. Phi is equal to 30 degree and unit weight of soil is given 16 kilonewton per meter cube. Spacing of counterfort, counterfort about 3 meter. And RCC unit weight of RCC or unit weight of RCC, which is equal to 25 kilonewton per meter cube, and use M15 grade concrete and Fe 250 steel. As I said earlier, now this is a typical example problem we will have to design for counter for retaining wall. No dimensions has been given, dimensions has to be taken derived, then your stability analysis, then your structural design. It is given height of wall above ground level is 5.5 meter. That means from ground level to above is 5.5 meter. And the soil below the ground level, its bearing capacity is given 160 kilonewton per meter square. Phi and gamma of the retaining soil is given. And spacing of counterfort walls is about 3 meter. And unit weight of RCC, reinforced concrete, 25 kilonewton per meter cube. And it has been planned to use M15 grade of concrete and 250 steel, mild steel 250 for designing this counterfort retaining wall. Now, first step is to find it out, this wall has to be, if I take this retaining wall like this, if I go for this counter for retaining wall like this, what will happen? You will have to consider some depth as a depth of the foundation, as a depth of the foundations. This depth of the foundation generally provided about 1 to 2 meter, either you can assume, or you can, this depth of foundation you can find it out from this. Depth of foundation, you can get it P by W into 1 minus sin phi by 1 plus sin phi whole square, where is your P is your say bearing capacity of soil, soil pressure in this case, and it is coming about 160,000. Divided by your W is your unit weight of soil, based on that it is coming about 16,000 into 1/3 whole square, which is coming about 1.11 meter. So, let us take about foundation depth. is equal to 1.2 meter foundation depth. Then once you are taking this foundation depth is equal to 1.5 meter, then overall height below the above the ground surface, overall height of wall, overall height of wall, overall height of the wall is equal to 5.5 plus 1.2, which is equal to 6.7 meter. If you look at here, it is given height of wall above ground level. The ground level is here, because retaining wall cannot stand above the ground level. You have to make sure that there is some foundation depth. Retaining wall has to be put it below the ground level. So, this height is given about 5.5. So, this depth of the foundation is we have taken 1.2. So, overall height of wall is coming about 6.7 meter. Now, thickness of the base of the wall, now the dimension, one this overall height and the depth of the foundation is over. Part 1 is your dimension of retaining wall, dimensions of the retaining wall. In this dimension of the retaining wall, first find it out your thickness of base slab. Thickness of base slab, you can get it as I have said earlier for counter for retaining wall, 41.7 root over of h. It should not be lower than that, and 20 L root over of h, and it is coming about to be 324 mm, and this coming about to be 402 mm. So, this thickness of base slab should not be lower than this. So, now we can take a higher value, let us provide thickness of the base slab say 400 mm. So, now the actual height of upright slab. Upright slab is your, this is your upright slab, this is your upright slab. So, thickness of base slab we have found out it is to be 400 mm, that means 0.4 meter. Now, this upright slab, for upright slab actual height, height of upright slab, height of upright slab is equal to 6.7 minus 0.4, which is equal to 6.3 meter. So, this height is about coming 6.3 meter. Now, depth is coming about, depth of the foundation it is coming about is equal to 1.2 meter. Now, we will have to find it out particularly designed for your upright slabs. In case of upright slab, what is your pressure intensity in upright slab? For upright slab, what is your pressure intensity? Pressure intensity is equal to gamma k a h, which is coming about 16,000 into 6.3 into 1/3. This is coming about 33,600 kilonewton per meter square. Now, maximum bending moment is coming about to be, maximum bending moment, which is equal to W L square by 12 or P L square by 12. P is your pressure intensity, P is equal to your pressure intensity, maximum bending moment is equal to P L square by 12. From there we can find it out, P is equal to 336,000 into 3 square by 12, and this comes out to be 25200 newton meter. So once you get maximum bending moment, then what we can suppose to get it, we can find it out your area of steel. This mild steel for M15 grade concrete, the permissible stress in concrete C is equal to, as I said earlier, it is equal to 5 Newton per mm square. For M15 grade concrete, then for mild steel Fe250 steel, permissible stress in steel T is equal to 140 Newton per mm square. Based on this, if I equate maximum bending moment to area of steel, this should be come out to be, you can either equate maximum bending moment to area of steel or maximum bending moment to your QBD square, because you have to find it out this thickness also. We got it base slab thickness. Now we will have to find it out thickness of your upright slab at the base. So from this QBD square, which is equal to maximum bending moment. So Q for M15 and 250 steel, it is 0.87 B into 1000 into D square, which is equal to 252 into 1000. So D is equal to 170 mm. Now if I am using effective cover of 40 mm, this is your effective cover, then it comes out to be 210 mm. Now let us say thickness of upright slab, let us say 210 mm. You can keep this thickness of this upright slab, either you can keep it this way or you can keep it continuous throughout. From top to bottom, this thickness will be same, there is no varying in thickness. So in this case, we are considering this thickness uniformly throughout, that means uniform throughout this thickness, we are considering this about 210 mm. Then after getting the thickness, means width of your upright slab at the base, it comes out to be 210 mm. Then thickness of your base slab is 0.4 meter or 400 mm. Now base width, this base width has to be come out and this width has to be come out, then we will go for your stability analysis. Next part is your base width. So base width is generally varying from 0.6h to 0.7h. So if I take total height, h is equal to 5.5, it is this height, upright slab is your, this height is there. So if I am taking into, this is coming about to be 6.7 into 0.6, 6.7 into 0.6, and this is your 6.7 into 0.7, it comes out to be 4.02 and 4.69 meter. Let us provide this base width is 4.5 meter. So base width is comes out to be 4.5 meter. If you look at here, this base width is generally 0.6 to 0.7 times of total height of this retaining wall. So total height, if I am taking it 6.7, 5.5 plus 1.2, this is coming about to be 6.7, 6.7 into 0.6, 6.7 into 0.7, this base width you can take it between 4.02 to 4.69 meter, either you can take it 4.03, 4.3, 4.5, 4.6, just I put it any value between this 4.5 meter base width. Now Next part is your toe projection. Toe projection means how much it will be projected if this is my retaining wall and this is your toe and this is heel and this part is called heel slab and this is your upright, this is your upright slab, this part is your, this entire part moving towards this, this is upright slab. Now how much is your toe has to projected beyond this retaining of soil mass? So this toe projection comes out to be, it says that one fourth of B, one fourth of B, and this value is your B. So this comes out to be 1.1 meter. So you can provide either 1.1 or you can provide a toe projection of 1 meter. Let us provide this toe projection of 1 meter. Now if I provide this toe projection of 1 meter, that means this dimension is almost over. Let us make a sketch how the dimensions of this, it looks completely retaining wall. You can show in a sketch of your tentative dimension for your stability analysis, 1.1 meter, and this is about to be, this is about your 1 meter and this is your 210 mm and this is your 0.4 meter and this is your 3.29 meter. So with this this is your tentative dimensions, and now with these tentative dimensions we'll check the stability analysis. If the stability analysis satisfies four factors of safety, one is your factor of safety against overturning, other is your factor of safety against sliding, and E should be your eccentricity should be less than equal to b/6, and bearing capacity, that means the dimensions are okay. If the stability analysis, if it is not satisfied, either you modify the dimension or you can go for some remedy. So we can check this now, the stability analysis, calculation of these forces, we can check how it is coming about, means total resisting force and driving forces all has to be calculated. Then once you calculate, then you can go for your bending moment and pressure at the base, all these things. Now if I name it, this is W2, this is W1, W2. You can name it W3 also. This part is your 6.3. This part is your W3. Now start one by one. So W1 is your, what is your W1? W1 is your weight of this upright slab from here to here. So that means unit weight, what is your width? 0.21 into 6.3 this to this height is your 6.3 into unit weight of concrete is 25,000, which comes out to be 33075 kilonewton. So this is a vertical force, because this is vertical downward by self weight, this is vertical downward. Similarly, you can find it out W2 is your weight of base slab, which is about to, this width is your 4.5 meter, this width is your 4.5 meter. So W2 is equal to 4.5 into 0.4 into 25,000, which is coming about to be 45,000, and this is again vertical. If I am putting it, these symbols and these symbols, this means force is acting vertical, this means force is acting lateral in that direction. Then third part is your W3 is equal to 3.29 into 6.3 into 16,000. If you look at here, 3.29 is this width and this height is your 6.3. With this counterforce, soil has to retain. So unit weight of soil is, again this is vertical, 16,000, and which is coming about to be 331632. Again this is vertical. Then fourth one is your earth pressure, that is your Ka gamma H square by 2, which is equal to 1/3 16,000 into 6.7 whole square by 2. Then, so earth pressure is there, then moment you can find it out from this moment, this is your pressure, then moment you can find it out Ka gamma H Q by 6, which is equal to 1/3 into 16,000 into 6.7 whole Q by 6. So now this is the vertical force and this is your lateral forces or horizontal forces acted by these directions. So these are about your force. Now you can find it out lever arm means this force acted how far from toe or how far from your heel. So in this case, from this toe, this W1 is coming about to be 1.105. So because it is 1 meter and 0.21 by 2, so this is coming about 1.105, and W2 is your, it is straightforward, it is half, it is coming about your 2.25, and W3 is coming about 2.855, and earth pressure will act at a distance 6.7 by 3. So then after that you find it out your clockwise movement and anti-clockwise movement. You find it out your two movements, clockwise movement and anti-clockwise movement about your toe. If you look at this, how this clockwise movement, all vertical forces, this will give a clockwise movement, lateral forces, earth pressure, this will give your anti-clockwise movement. That means if I write is clockwise movement and anti-clockwise movement, and from this you can find it out this clockwise movement, all the term for W1, it is coming about 36547.8, and this is coming about 101250.0, and W3 is coming about 9468.09.36. So, and anti-clockwise moment is coming 267345. So, this comes out to be 108.4607.2. So, now net movement you can find it out. Net movement is equal to clockwise movement minus anti-clockwise movement, which is coming about to be 8172.62.24 newton meter. Now we can check, you can find it out eccentricity, you can find it out. This is the resultant force R acted. So, how far from your CG, how far from your CG you can find it out E. So, first find it out your x bar, distance of your eccentricity x bar from the toe, which is equal to m by v, total movement resisting as well as clockwise as well as anticlockwise, and total vertical forces, it is coming about to be 8172.62.24/409707, which is equal to 1.99, and E is equal to B by 2 minus X bar, which is equal to 0.26. So, B by 6 is equal to 0.75, that means E is equal to less than B by 6, which means there is no tension crack. One stability criteria has been satisfied. We find it out what is your eccentricity. Eccentricity should be less than B by 6, that means there is no tension crack, that means there is no tension crack below the base of the slab. There's what do you mean by tension crack? Once there is a tension crack, there is a gap between soil and the wall. So, there is no gap between soil and wall. So, similarly factor of safety against sliding, you can check from this factor of safety against sliding, it is coming about 4.0, which is okay. I just leave it for you. Then sorry, factor of safety against sliding is coming about 1.711. You can assume mu is equal to friction between concrete and soil is equal to 0.5. You can assume this friction between concrete and soil is equal to 0.5. So, 1.771 now, which is okay, which is greater than your 1.5. So, and your factor of safety against bearing capacity also it is okay, it satisfy. Now, we can find it out what is the value of P maximum at the base and P minimum. It will be calculated with V by B 1 plus 6 E by B, and it will be calculated V by B total vertical force V by B 1 minus 6 E by B, and this comes out to be 121394 Newton per mm square, and this comes out to be 60697 Newton per mm square. So, now if I draw it, this is my pressure distribution is coming. So, this pressure distribution, this part is coming about 121394, then 60697, this is your pressure distribution around this below the base of the slab. What I did after the dimension has been fixed based on the calculation or based on the assumption value, then you can do it systematically by taking into your forces, which is your vertical forces, lateral forces, then clockwise movement and anticlockwise movement, So I have made it into very small part so that there will not be any mistake. I make it upright slab as W1, base slab is your W2, soil retaining in the counterfort part, this is your W3, then is your how much is earth pressure coming, all I have taken into small part and total movement has been calculated. Once you calculate your total movement and total vertical force also, you can calculate from here, from this, what is your total vertical forces. So X bar, you can find it out, from there you can find it out eccentricity, and you check it whether E is less than B/6 or not. If E is less than B/6, that means there is no tension crack, one factor of safety satisfied. Second factor of safety against sliding has been checked. I leave it for the student to calculate. It is about 1.711, which is greater than 1.5. Mu has been assumed as 0.5, and also factor of safety against overturning as well as factor of safety against bearing capacity has also been checked. It is within this limit. Then once this stability analysis has been done, then what will happen? These dimensions, whatever we have taken, that is okay now. That is okay now. So step 1, dimension is okay. Step 2, stability analysis has been done. Step 3 is your design, structural design of your RCC counterfort retaining walls. So from this stability analysis, we calculated P maximum, maximum pressure below the base of the wall, minimum pressure below the base of the wall, and now in the next class, we will go for your structural design of your counterfort retaining wall.
Thanks a lot.